Go live. Huh?
Oh yeah, the only thing I was thinking, I guess.
With MailChimp's customer journey smarts, you can track when a customer buys something, plan for their next purchase, and set up follow-up emails to drive even more sales.
What is that?
Drifting away, a vision so dark, I cannot stay.
At the Chicago School of Professional Psychology's new Anaheim campus, we offer more than an education. We offer a chance to enrich lives through immersive academic experiences. You'll train with accomplished professionals, engage in field opportunities in underserved communities, and explore diverse perspectives to help expand your worldview. Get more from your education at the Chicago School's Anaheim campus. Learn more at thechicagoschool.edu.
Let me freeze time before it turns cold. The moments go by and life goes on. The torturous stars are taking every breath. I wish I'd held the love in my heart. It's never ending.
Hi guys, here I am. I got ready here. Let me just do some checks here. Okay, cool. Do you see me now too? Hello? you see me? Can you hear me too? Is that better? Yes! Technology is working. Hello. Okay, let me say hi to everyone. Right, who we got here? We got Frankie, Magdalena, Navy Boy USA. Thank you for your service. Doc Mike. Who else we got? Charlie Hamilton. Flamio. Frankie, Joseph, George, Gildon, Maura, Rodriguez, Gil. Tamuito, Vaxo, Volume. Does that mean it's really good or really bad? Oh, thank you. Hi, Charlie. The sound could be louder. Okay, hang on, I'll put it up. How's that? Is that better? Can you hear me better now? Okay, great. All right, so hi, everyone.
Yes.
Yeah, we got Pizzi there too. Gosh, this is great. I know it's been a really long time since I've done one of these. I just want to start off this live stream by saying thank you so much to all of you for all your support. It has meant the absolute world. I wouldn't be here without you. I wouldn't be able to still be making music if it wasn't for you guys. Your messages, your likes, your shares, your follows, your subscriptions, your downloads, your purchases, your streams, all of it just is absolutely everything to me, and I thank you so much. So with that in mind, I wanted to have some live conversations with you guys. I'm going to try and do this every couple of weeks and bring on some different guests, people that I love to bits, that I work with behind the scenes. One thing I've noticed in social media is that you guys really love the behind the scenes stuff. So our first live conversation with RAIGN, I suppose we could call it. I don't know, maybe you guys can help me name this series, but this is episode one of whatever we name it. And today I've got two of my most favorite guys in the world. I think we might just only have one of them right now. The other one will be on with us later. But Mysto and Pizzi are the producers behind so many of my amazing songs. They did my whole first EP with me and other ones too that have been coming out on following EPs and albums. And we still have songs in the vault as well that we still haven't even released yet. Every different song has a different life, a different journey, an adventure of its own. Sometimes it's super frustrating. We have to wait so long to release music sometimes, and sometimes they come straight out. It's always different, depends on the story. But today we're going to be talking specifically about Don't Let Me Go, which most of you probably heard on the Vampire Diaries, and it was an absolute life-changing moment for me and one of the most thrilling weeks. So let me bring on Pizzi real quick. We can all say hi to him. This should work. Hopefully this works.
Ah! Everyone, do you hear me?
Yes. Hello, Pizzi.
Hey.
Can you turn yourself up a little bit for us?
My volume?
Yeah, you're a little bit quiet, I think.
Hello, you hear me?
Yeah.
Much better now?
Yeah, that's great. And then I'm going to turn you down a bit here so it's clearer.
Nice.
Sorry, guys. This is our first one. So we're just checking out all this technology that... Pizzi showed me how to use it all basically like in the middle of the night so that we were ready for today. I'm not a great person with technology, so I'm also just going to share this YouTube stream with a few more people real quick that are bugging me for the actual link. So just please give me a second. Pizzi, while I'm doing this, please tell us all about, like, where are you right now?
Right now I'm in my home studio, you know, been tapping in with RAIGN, you know, couple days, you know, wanted to get this right, you know, figuring out all the technology, the back end stuff, but you know, so far so good, so far, you know, like happy to be on the chat, you know. It's been a long time too since, you know, me and RAIGN actually connected, you know, past couple of weeks we've been working on some new music and stuff, you know, so it's kind of like refreshing, you know, getting, you know, back in the zone with our girl, you know.
I love you guys so much. Honestly, I'm telling you, this guy is so talented. He is an absolute genius on all the instruments, on the programming, on the Ableton, on the Pro Tools, on the Logic. And just when we can tell about how we met in a minute, but when we met in New York, right? Did we meet in New York?
Yeah.
So I went on a trip to New York because I just wanted to. You know, this happens quite a lot in my life. And I think it's an annoying quality for some people, but it's actually a really strong quality in any kind of self-employment type industry. But I just decided I needed to go to New York, and I just went. And, you know, I couldn't really afford it. I was still broke at the time, living in LA on people's sofas and stuff. And I said, I have to go to New York. And I was lucky enough to get introduced to somebody from Ultra when I was in New York. Wasn't that how we met? Through one of the A&Rs at Ultra Records. And he said, okay, I really hear your voice on some kind of EDM music. And I have these amazing guys called Mysto and Pizzi. And so I didn't know I was going to meet Mysto and Pizzi when I came to New York. But then when I was in New York, it was only like a few days before I was about to leave, I think, too. He said, you got to meet these boys. Like, were you already living in the East Village then?
No, we wasn't.
No. Yeah. So where did I come and meet you guys that first time? Do you remember?
Maspeth, the basement, the original.
The first original time studio. When I met you?
Yeah.
And then was that when I lost my phone? I left it in the Uber? Or was that another time? Anyway, I met you
was
guys.
Was it the same time?
I don't know.
No, I think it was a different time because he was already writing. It had so many lyrics in there. He was freaking out because it's like, oh, my writing.
I know.
Oh,
I know. So on another trip, sidebar, I went over to do a writing session with you. I think we were doing Empire that day. We were doing Empire of Our Own that day. That was the day that we wrote the melody in your bedroom for Empire of Our Own. And I think that was the first song we did. So this was the East Village. It was the East Village.
But that was like later on, before Don't Let
Me Go. Oh, okay. Yeah, this is before Don't Let Me Go. Yeah, so then, so on one of my, I think it was that trip, I left my phone in the Uber and I was freaking out because I write all my lyrics and melodies on voice notes and on the notepad. And so I was like, I've just lost my whole life. I've just lost everything. That's it. I'm just going to give up. I've lost my phone. I've lost everything. I don't think we had like iCloud backups that was like maybe 9 years ago.
Yeah.
Anyway, so this guy from Ultra said, you got to meet these guys. They're so talented. So I actually came to work with you to do something for your project, right? And then... And then we ended up writing Empire of Our Own. And then you guys were like, we want to work on your stuff too. This needs to be for you. And then didn't we go out clubbing and you guys played Empire in the club? Like it was like the earliest.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
We kind of did like a super quick rendition of it real quick just to like test it out.
See how it was. And I think it was like the first time ever that I'd heard myself on a song being played in a club. That was before Fix Me and all the EDM stuff that happened later. I'm going to get to all your questions in a bit, guys. I see them all coming here, but if I read them, I'll lose my train of thought really easily. And then, so, Pizzi, tell me, you guys were already kind of YouTube famous at the time, right? Because you were doing loads of, back in the day, I don't know how long before that was, you were doing loads of, like, YouTube videos and stuff?
Yeah, you know, that's kind of, you know, where we kind of started, you know, just doing videos, you know, behind the scenes, you know, stuff of us just, you know, making music, writing. But during that time period, you know, we were, you know, doing a lot of EDM records with those Ultra Records at the time. And, you know, but we was making a little bit of a transition, trying to get back into our roots of doing more pop music and just, you know, more, you know, down-tempo stuff. And she came at the perfect timing because, you know, was more into stuff like, you know, Florence and Santi Gold.
Oh, yeah.
So, you know, we're like, you know, trying to, you know, not branch away too much from EDM, but just trying to find a new direction, a new wave, something more deep, you know, more impactful and, you know, just, you know, big records, like just big, nice records, you know, great writing. So,
yeah.
So from there, yeah, that's when we ran into RAIGN.
And then didn't you guys write for Kelly Rowland one time?
Yeah.
Yeah, you know, you did
some
stuff
done,
for Kelly,
you know,
right?
A bunch of R&B records, hip hop records, you know, a bunch of TV placements for like, you know, TV commercials and stuff like that. But, you know, we really wanted to, you know, tap into, you know, just making like great music, just great writing, you know. And I think it was also a transition too where, you know, great music started to like slowly come out again and, you know, people were going back into the pen, you know, and things started, you know, just sounding more organic. And, you know, it was like, oh man, it's like the perfect time to like transition to, you know, work with RAIGN and writing, because we wasn't really working with too much writers, because when you're doing EDM music, you don't really need to, you know, you work with writers, but, you know, not really writing full songs, bridges, etc.
And I think you guys were like the first people who ever said to me, you need to do a project, you need to do your own album. Because at the time, I was also kind of running around all over the place in LA, London, New York, trying to write songs to get cut on other artists, wasn't I? And I mean, I always, what the plan always was to, I mean, I always felt in my heart like I was an artist. But when I first signed my publishing deal to, it was EMI at the time, they were like, in the meantime, you can just write a ton of songs and we can write, you know, you can always write for other people. And I think I'd just got the Rita Ora cut at the time and I was writing a lot with Ty Dolla $ign. So I kind of lost track a little bit of wanting to write my own stuff, which is totally fine. I mean, it was a really amazing like journey experience and I learned so much. But it was like perfect timing when I met you guys because I, like, it was all pent up inside me. And I knew exactly what I wanted to sing about. And you guys just were so great at pulling that out of me. You were like, be that regal person. Or I don't know. I don't remember exactly. Like, you guys gave me the confidence to sing about. Because I thought the stuff I wanted to sing about was kind of poetic and weird. And nobody else was singing about that kind of stuff. And you were like, no.
Yeah. So here's the thing. It was really, I think for us, it was more about you were doing a certain type of vibe, certain type of song. But you had these. A big voice, you know, for like big hooks, and it just sounded very regal and just grand. So you could see your voice in certain records, you know, where it's like, oh man, this could be, you know, huge, you know, because you know, you were really just writing for other people. So you wasn't like writing really for yourself.
No.
It was more like you were more focusing. You know, the songs were great. Don't get me wrong.
Yeah.
Were, you know, super awesome songs.
Yeah, it was fun.
With your voice and, you know, your feel, you know, it was a whole different direction compared to. Know the direction it was like writing for other people at the time, so yeah, that's what kind of intrigued us. Is like, well, she could do this,
yeah,
know.
And then you guys were such,
imagine what her voice sound like, oh, on these kind of records, you know, very, you know, a more emotional, deep, you know, darker, you know.
I love you guys so much, seriously. You're doing it again now, like you just made me feel like I could do it. And like, mm-hmm. a message out there to every creative person in the world, like, no matter how confident performers or any creative people might come across in any situation, no matter how confident and arrogant or strong or anything we come across, we're all actually like terrified that we're terrible, and we all have these moments like constantly where we're like, is this any good? Like, this is just not good. So collaboration is the key. Collaboration is always the key, because collaboration is how you find your people that bring the best out of you, and also that your mirror, that you guys were saying to me, you are good, you've got to do this, we've got to do this, this type of sound is good, you have to, this is who you are, you have to do this. So thank you, Pizzi, because I don't think, yes. I'd be where I am right now if you hadn't have been a part of that part of my journey. So that was the first trip to New York, and then I was hooked. So I think I came to New York how many times, because I was like, I have to keep going back and writing songs. I even tried to move to New York the next winter.
Yeah,
but I was like,
we tried to move,
it's too cold, definitely. I can't do it. Once the problem is that once you come and live in LA has its good points and its bad points for sure. Like, it's not the perfect place, but it is also a land of dreams. Like, you can make your dreams happen here for sure. But it's the weather. You just can't live anywhere else after you've been here. Like, so many people said to me, why aren't you going back to England for the pandemic? And I was like, well, first, it's too dangerous to fly back right now, especially with a 2-year-old, or he was one at the time, unvaccinated and all of that. So we kind of were trapped here. Because normally I go backs and forwards. And then second, I was like, and why? Why would I spend a lockdown in a cold place? You know?
Yeah.
So thank God I was able to, I have, you know, actually my apartment's here. So it was easier to stay here. But anyway, so let's get to the questions and to Don't Let Me Go. So the Vampire Diaries. So how did that happen? So I think we had known each other for maybe like 6 months at that point. I think I might have done like 2 trips to New York already. And we'd been working on Empire and maybe a couple of other things. Did we do Kiss Me 1000? We had started Kiss Me maybe already by then,
yeah,
too?
Yeah, we started Kiss Me. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So the songs, as I said at the beginning, don't come out in the order that we make them. They come out in a really strange order, and there's many reasons behind that. But we had started a few songs, but we didn't really have a direction. And then I did a song camp with Sony ATV. It was still EMI at the time, I think. Maybe it had just changed. And I was in a session and I was asked specifically to write, it was a song camp, just to write sync songs. And I met another really amazing friend of mine who I'm going to bring on this live stream series, whatever we call it, in a few weeks' time, Andrea Wass. And we wrote a song called Raise the Dead. And the music supervisor for The Vampire Diaries, he is an absolute angel. He's like literally an angel sent from heaven to me. His name is Chris Malaire, and he was in our session, and he heard the song as we were making Raise the Dead. So I still wasn't calling myself RAIGN at that point, because I don't know if we were like super sure what to call myself yet. We'd already met, and I did Raise the Dead, and that was literally on the originals like 3 weeks later. So the originals was the first song that I ever had. Raise the Dead was the first song I ever had on a vampire show. So that was on the originals. Thank you, Frankie. I do love Raise the Dead. It was definitely like the very beginning of this journey, and I wasn't kind of 100% sure where I was going, but we wrote that song specifically for the original, so that's why that theme was like that. And then that same music supervisor hit me up, I think maybe like 5 months later, and he said, okay, I've got this scene in the Vampire Diaries and it needs a song, and the main character that everybody loves is dying, and I'm going to send you the scene and we need a song, but we need it in a week because we already have a placeholder song in there. Do you think I'm allowed to tell people what the placeholder
is? I don't know why I remember 3 days. They said a
week.
Said three, I don't know.
I probably gave you guys 3 days.
Like, you guys have like, or maybe you told us 3 days, actually. Because I remember the story much different. I remember you said we have 3 days to do this song.
Nicole, I just read that. That's crazy. But that's exactly synchronicity. That's what this is all about. Thank you for joining us. So I probably told you guys 3 days, but we had a week. And so, we had to write a song to the scene, and it was so cool to, it was the first time I'd ever written a song to a scene. It was so cool to be able to write it to the scene. So we actually saw it without any special effects, and we saw the timing. So we figured out, the first thing that we did on the call was we figured out the timing of how fast our song needed to be to fit the scene edits, right? So that was the first thing that we did.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
And actually that's not true. The very first thing that happened was I watched the scene that he sent me, like a file of the scene, and the second I started watching the scene, I heard in my head, "Don't let me go," and I was like, "Oh my god, oh my god, oh my god, I've got the title, oh my god, thank you, thank you." I always believe that songs are already written and they're kind of like floating around in the atmosphere, and like the angels are singing them to us. That's how I feel. And that's what I tap into to be able to write a song. And so sometimes it's like I have to get myself in the right state and the right frame of mind to be able to hear it, but it's there all the time. And so I was like, thank you. I'm always so grateful. It's like, thank you. You gave it to me in like one split second. So I had the title, and then so I just, you know, I was like, Pizzi, we got to do this. We got to do this. So we talked on the phone, and I sang a rough melody down the phone, and you have something to play us now, which is like, this is breaking news, guys. No one has ever heard this. Just play a short, tiny bit of it. But this is the very first stage. This is so cool that I'm sharing this with you guys. Honestly, I just really want people to understand, if there's any budding songwriters out there, or artists out there, or producers out there, or creative people, I just really want to empower you to know that things don't come out perfect, and there's a stage to everything. And so here is what Don't Let Me Go sounded like at first. Oh my God, this is scary.
Carry it with me on the wings of death. I've 1,000,000 winding bump in life. I'm in days and what you bought in life. Bought and bought it.
That is literally
what I did. The foes and what you bought in life. I'm in days you won't want in life. They will beg you up for something like, oh, the lying.
So that, guys, is what Don't Let Me Go sounded like before it had lyrics or music. And you can even hear Pizzi talking at the very end. That's over the phone.
Yeah, I'm saying like, that's cool. Like, I like that part.
In light on the wings of death.
I was on there. Never let it rise. No, been I feel you in there. Feeling.
Wow.
And that was it. Like, literally, we did that, you know, 1 minute, 11 second piece. And what's crazy, too, is so I was, as I'm going through the files, you know, seeing pretty much how it started, the date was April 13th. And I remember that day was my best friend's birthday. And I remember getting the call from Rachel, like, hey, like, we have this, you know, opportunity, you know, we got to hop on it. We have 3 days to do it, you know, and I'm like, hey, it's my best friend's birthday. Like, I told Mysto, get the speakers. You guys going to have to come over here because, you know, I'm kind of loyal to my friends. You know, I said, I promise I was going to hang out with them that day. But, you know, I have a thing I need to do. So we literally set up the studio in his living room and we're going back and forth on webcam, you know, with Rachel, you know, writing, you know, getting, you know, all the parts in. And yeah, it was crazy, literally.
I mean, and I can't thank you enough for that. I mean, like, you were like, it was never going to be like 100% sure that they would use the song because they had another song in the scene. So it was just literally like, okay, if it's good enough, we'll use it. And then I remember when we sent, so the version that you just played, is that what we sent them? We sent them that, right?
Yeah.
Before it had any, like, it had
first rough. Yeah.
It had chorus lyrics and that was it. What you just played had some chorus lyrics, but it didn't have any lyrics in the it did not have any lyrics in the verses yet. And so we sent them that just because they were like desperate to know if what we were coming up with was gonna work. And I remember him saying to Chris Malaire, saying to me on the phone, oh my goodness, oh my goodness, oh my goodness, this is the one. I am so happy, I'm so happy, please finish this. So then what was the next step? The next step was, I got a little treat for you guys here. So the next step, after we had like done our phone call, we'd made a melody together. I already had the song title. I'd done the chorus lyrics by then. You'd started to make a really amazing track. These guys are literally the best guys at making tracks. I mean, their tracks just like get in my heart. And like, it's really funny because most of the time I see you guys choreographing dances to the tracks. It's the Mysto and Pizzi ones that I've done. So it's like you guys, they just make the perfect songs to dance to. I'm just going to answer a really couple questions real quick and then I'll carry on to the next stage of what we did because I don't want to ignore you guys and they're all showing up here and so I don't want to miss it. Okay, I said hello to you guys. You guys are amazing in this chat. It's fantastic.
Yeah, Frankie JP, cinematic. Perfect, the exact word I'm looking for. When we heard her voice, it was just like, sounded so cinematic, like, you know, stuff or like perfect with scoring, you know, Hans Zimmer vibes, because that's the transition was really, you know, trying to go for, you know, once we heard her voice, it's like, all right, we got the EDM thing, it's going good, now let's, you know, try to get back to, you know, getting more deeper, you know, more musical string arrangements.
Yeah, because I remember saying to you, like, I used to play the violin and the clarinet, that was my first two instruments, and I just love classical music, but I also just love EDM, dance, electronic. I love all of it, and I love the organs and the spiritual things. So, like, how can we mash the three things together? And honestly, having this opportunity to do Don't Let Me Go, it made me level up. It made me realize that, I mean, okay, I'm going to tell you that the song that I had to beat was a Florence and the Machine song. Can you believe we had to beat a Florence? There was a Florence and the Machine song in the scene already, and they used ours instead. Now, I love Florence and the Machine so much, but that moment was like pressure because I was like, how can I ever write a song that's as good as their song? You know, like, it's just, I don't know if that, I don't like it. I had to push myself. I had to dig deep and find inside me what this scene required. And honestly, I think it's the scene that really helped me, because when you say cinematic, actually it was seeing the picture and like really feeling these characters on screen and what was going on that gave me the song. Like, that inspired me to write a better song. I Googled because Don't Let Me Go came on while I was reading, and now you have a live stream. Shock with the timing. That is synchronicity. That is just how it goes. Thanks, Nicole. Roman, I don't want to say your name wrong. I'm going to try Kubalik. Roman, where are you messaging us from? Hey, can you just all hit me up with where you're coming in from? I just love to see that you guys, where you guys all are. Since I've never watched The Vampire Diaries, I'm so thankful to The X Factor for allowing me to find your music. Seeing you back makes me so happy. Aw, thank you so much. I haven't been anywhere. I've been here the whole time, but I know what you mean. I don't do very many lives, and I'm going to do more. This is super fun. Now we figured out the technology behind it. And so what else do we have? I love your songs. Miranda, hello from Georgia. Is that Georgia the state or Georgia the country? Let me know where you are. What else do we have here? Joseph Carver says, I love, hi Joseph, I speak to you a lot, don't I? And Frankie P. And Paris as well, you're there. It sounded like it was in Simlish. What does Simlish mean? Is that like a language, a mythological language that I need to know about? Yeah, so the way your songs build up to this amazing moment is amazing. Don't Let Me Go is so good. And during the Vampire Diaries, I was in tears. I know, I literally was in tears when I watched the scene before it had the music. So guys, honestly, it's really not just the music, it's the scene. The scene is just incredible, the way they made that scene. Yes, I actually, that's an intentional thing. I always try and put a build in the songs. I feel like life is a build. I feel like all the good things that we love in life always have this like, kind of like pinnacle moment, like the pyramid effect. So that's actually an intentional songwriting thing. And I do it because I love it. And I'll tell you where it comes from so naturally to me. And Pizzi, you probably understand this too. It comes from the blues. So like there's always an explosive moment in blues music and rock music too. Mm-hmm. So like I used to listen to a lot of rock music, and that's the main difference between rock and then pop. Pop, you lose the build and the climax, right? You lose it a little bit because it kind of like levels off a bit more in pop, the momentum of the song, which those songs are great too. But me, whenever I've gone to a concert or wherever I did like a blues jam, I don't know if you guys know this, this is a sidebar, like a small fact, not sure I've ever mentioned much about, but I actually have been performing a lot since about 2008. So God, how long is that now? I can't do math, like 13 years. So I started off singing in karaoke bars in England, and I very quickly got pulled into a scene called the blues jam scene. So I would go to like all the local dive bars and get up on stage and do a blues jam, which would be kind of like random people called up on stage to sing a standard. It's just that I never knew any of the standards because I'm terrible at learning anyone else's song lyrics. Terrible. I cannot remember lyrics that I didn't write. It's so weird. Even if I love the song, I'm still singing made up lyrics half the time. But so I would get up on stage and tell them to play a blues in G, and I would just make up a song. So I would literally just sing any old song. And I loved watching other people do them with the guitar solos. And that's always the best part of the song for me, when there's like a big epic moment. So I love to put those into songs. Sorry, I rambled quite a bit then. What else do we have here? Suggestions for your podcast name. Okay, Queen de Moraine. I could never call myself that. I can't. I love it, but I can't be that proud. Reigns Queendom. Oh, you're so sweet. Thank you. Empire of Our Own. That's cool. You wrote Empire. You didn't write Empire, but how about Empire of Our Own? Shine. Oh, I love Rain and Shine. Rain Down on Me. I might get in a bit of trouble if I did that one. The Rainbow Room. That's so good.
I like that one.
Rainbow Room. That's amazing. Hi, I loved you. Hi, Lisa Kadik. That was Navy Boy USA, by the way, who gave us those awesome names. So we're definitely going to think on those. Thank you. So Lisa Kadik, where are you? Said, hi, I loved you on The X Factor. Your songs are unique. Your voice is amazing. I'm from Derbyshire. Hi, I miss England so much right now. My mum's actually coming out here to see me finally in a few weeks. I am just going to cry when she comes here. I haven't seen my mum for 16 months. And we actually were in England just before the lockdown. So we randomly flew back to LA about 2 weeks before they locked us all down. So I haven't been to England for 16 months and I just miss it so much. And Doc Mike, you're in Poole in Dorset. Hello, Poole in Dorset. Interesting how it's all kind of flamio. I'm sorry. It's so difficult to know how to pronounce people's names. I don't want to say it wrong. It's the worst thing. Interesting how it's all interconnected. Movie without music feels empty, and it's cool if the music... Yeah, it was inspired by the movie scene. Do writing for film and TV series, music, gigs, more excitement than writing for normal pop songs. I do it... Honestly, Pizzi, we all do it all, right? We don't ever like focus in on one thing for too long because you...
Yeah.
Creativity doesn't really allow that. Sims is the PC game. Oh, the Sims PC game, and that's the fake language they speak. Yeah. So you guys are picking up my fake language. So a lot of songwriters that I know, we all do a similar thing to stop us from like getting writer's block or being stuck halfway when we're thinking of a melody. And Pizzi, you're really awesome at writing melodies too. So Pizzi helped me with the melodies for Don't Let Me Go as well. We kind of just talk gibberish. And that way we can just carry on and stop and make sure we don't lose an idea as it comes to us. When am I coming to England for a performance? As soon I'll build a coffin. PC Cross, how did you pull that one out of the archives? Build a coffin for my love. As I something through the dark. I don't remember it now. I don't remember it. I have to look that one up. I'll talk about when it's all over another time. Okay, so here's a little treat for you. So the next thing I do is lyrics. So I write tons of lyrics. So here we go. So I write tons of random lyrics. So these are my notepads, and you can see here that this started on the 12th of April 2014 at 7:29 p.m. So that was after me and Pizzi's first phone call. And anyone that kind of like wants to learn how to write songs or poems or anything like that, one of the things I realize people don't let themselves do, like when I'm talking to new people coming up and working with new writers and new artists, they kind of stop themselves and they don't just let themselves flow because they think, no, that's rubbish, that's bad, that's bad. So as soon as I stopped doing that and I just wrote the bad stuff down and moved on to the next line, I realized it's kind of like a river and you need to just let the river flow and not stop it. So I've shared 4 pages with you here. There's literally 50 of them, all from that night. And it just went on and on and on for about 2 days.
And also with writing too, you know, when you you know, create something, you may not like it in the moment. You know, you may not like that idea in the moment. 4 years later, you open up the session. 3 months later, you
I
open
know,
up the,
so true.
The note, and you're like, oh, this is
really good.
Oh, you get it then, you know. So, you know.
Yeah. So, tell us about the production side of stuff, please, Pizzi, a little bit. Tell us, like, if you can remember the kind of journey with the production here, and like any favorite sounds you used. Or kind of like what order you did everything in. And
so once we kind of started working with you, was, you know, we started, you know, building out orchestral paths, because, you know, we usually had like the more synthier kind of sounding strings, but we started getting more elements that were actual strings, you know, that actually sounded, you know, just sonically bigger, like the piano, for, you know, the pianos, you could actually hear the mallets on the when it's hitting the strings of the piano. So, you know, just paying attention to little detail like that, because when you're dealing with, you know, TV syncs and stuff like that, sometimes they would use parts of the instrumental, you know, so you would always want to be at the highest quality, or if there's a break or like a soft part of the song, like, gotta have a lot of dynamic, pretty much. We started focusing more on dynamics of the music, you know, working with RAIGN, because we know there's certain parts that could be used for a scene where it's just like, you know, more soft, more subtle, but, you know, still more organic, you know, organic strings, pianos, you know, to kind of like set that tone for that piece. And then if it gets big, you know, dramatic, you know, big strings, you know, timpanis, you know, live timpanis, big, you know, tribal drums, you know, been, you know, since, you know, been writing with RAIGN, I would say our production pack definitely starts to grow in that kind of collection of, you know, sounds, and, you know, more soundscapes, pads, you know, because we was trying to go for more of a ethereal, you know, kind of sound, you know, working with her. So I have to say that's definitely one of the production, you know, points.
Yeah.
For sure.
Yeah, you guys are amazing. And then, so how many versions of the production do you think you did on this song?
Oh, so I was looking for some stuff. Actually, look like about like 6 versions.
6. You know?
More than that. 10. So the last version, the final mix, it was 10.8. So that means there was probably like 10 versions.
And then 8 versions of 10.
Yeah, 8 versions of 10, you know, going from the mix. So the first date was April.
Hi, Sylvia.
Oh,
sorry.
First date was actually
you.
April 12th. First yeah. day, April 12th, 5:40 p.m.
Yeah.
And the last recent, like the final Don't Let Me Go, like December, like once we kind of got in, yeah.
Lost you. Pizzi, I lost you.
You hear me?
Yeah, I've got you now.
Yeah, so like April like 16th, you would say. From beginning to end.
So
you know?
4 days.
Then, you know, we go into the master phase.
Yeah.
You know, then the recutting it phase. We recorded at Treehouse actually, you know, just to get like the final in. But yeah. From creative to like final product, I would say like about a week. You know. From what was like just happy with it, you know.
Yeah, man. I mean, it was literally a whirlwind. And then I had to go and do a vocal session. So we booked a studio in Hollywood called Treehouse. And I recorded all the vocals and sent them off to you guys. And then we realized that we wanted more backing vocals. So I went back in a mm-hmm. second time and did the backing vocals. Then we had to send a version into the CW Network people because they just needed to put it to the picture. So we just had to send it to them where it was at that point. So another interesting fact is that the version of the song, it's the same version of the song, but okay, the master of the song that is in. So mastering is what you do to music when it's all finished. You finished all the music, the recording, the instruments, it's all mixed exactly how you want it. It's kind of like a filter, like an Instagram filter, right? Kind of, right, Pizzi?
Yeah.
Like an Instagram filter. So it's, the actual song doesn't change and the relativity of everything in the song stays the same, but slightly different filters have to go onto the song depending on what it's being used for.
Mm-hmm. So pretty much you make it like you make the quality standard for, say you're playing it on your AirPods and then you're hearing it coming out of your TV, it'll sound the same. It'll sound as good. If you don't do a mastering process, it might sound different when it's playing through a TV or playing through your car, playing through radio, you know, the quality, you know, mastering pretty much helps enhance the quality across all the board on whatever medium you're listening to your music.
Yeah, and we hadn't finished that process yet when they needed the final song for the Vampire Diaries, so we had to just give it to them in the version that it was. We had to just give them that version and that went on the show. And then we knew that it was going to be on the show literally in 3 weeks' time. So there was like only a 3 week lag from us finishing it to it being on television. And we had like another 3 weeks then to kind of like tweak it. And then so we released it to the world on Spotify. And on what else? Something else happened in those 3 weeks, Pizzi. So mm-hmm. in those 3 weeks, I had to decide what to call myself. And we had to make the artwork.
So that was kind of crazy because then it's like, okay, we got the music. And at this point, we're like the three trifecta, like, all right, what we're going to do, you know, like how we're going to package this.
Yeah.
Because she wasn't really an artist. That she was just pretty much still kind of writing. So we said, let's just fully package it. So we had our good friend, Alexa Casanova. At the time, he was designing for like Marc Jacobs and, you know, Mysto, Rachel. We all came together and said, let's try to create a vision board, you know, how she's going to look. What was kind of like her vision, you know, for herself, like this new sound, because it was completely different from a lot of the stuff that she's been writing. You know, even though we did write stuff that was similar to that vibe,
we had Empire already.
Nothing was really out yet.
Yeah.
You know, this would be like the first, you know, like RAIGN, you know, premiere.
Yeah. And I remember waking up in the middle of the night and I was still living in North Hollywood. And like, so two things happened like simultaneously. And this is how connected you guys are with me, because I think I was chatting to you a lot about the music stuff, but then I was also talking to Mysto, who's not here right now, but he's the other half of Mysto and Pizzi. And I was talking to Mysto a lot about the visuals for it all. He's super into art and stuff as well. So two things happened. Like, after we delivered the song to Chris Miller, I went to go and stay at my grandma's apartment for the weekend, and she actually lived at the time. She's passed away now, bless her. But she lived in Pacific Palisades up on the cliff. And so I lived in an awful, horrible, like the cheapest apartment I could find just so that I could afford to stay in LA, in North Hollywood. So I would always go and stay with my grandma when I felt like I needed to get out of the hot valley. And so I went to the beach to stay with her for the weekend. And I was also, I needed to take my mind off the fact that we had to wait and make sure that they were going to use it. So there was like a whole weekend. I think we delivered it on Friday, and it was on the Monday that they called us to tell us, yes, it's definitely in. So that weekend I spent at my grandma's house. And I remember standing, it was April, so it wasn't that hot. It was nice and fresh. And I remember standing on the cliff and looking out over the Pacific Ocean with all these rocks around me and kind of just going, oh my God. And then like in that second, I had this image in my head of me on the rocks like this, kind of like in this position. And I called Mysto instantly and he was like, oh my God, we've been making a picture of you standing on the rocks. Okay, we need to do a photo shoot right now. This is so crazy. We both had the exact same idea. So we need to do a photo shoot right now and get that picture. And so we had to make that whole thing in like 3 days. And then at the same time, I think it must have been the night before because it was in my North Hollywood apartment. I woke up in the middle of the night and I thought, what if I want to call myself Rain, like rain from the sky. And then you guys were like, but you're regal like a queen. And I didn't really feel like that. I felt like I was more like blue and emotional, like the rain. Mm-hmm. So we decided all together on the phone, like, let's join it together. So it's like blue and emotional, like the rain. And also there's kind of like a holy quality to water, like a, so kind of like a spiritual healing quality. So I wanted to like put that energy of songs healing people into the whole project. Because songs have healed me so much in my life. There's been so many times in my life, probably the same with you, Pizzi. I know almost every creative person I speak to got into music because of how music helped them through such a hard time at one point, and they realized that it was just such a magical thing, music. So we put the two together, and so it just all, I mean, in like that week, it just all came together. It was kind of like a volcano.
Very, very long nights editing, because yeah. You know, it's like, all right, we did the whole music piece, now it's like visual, and you know, we're up with Lex, you know, all night just on Photoshop, you know, trying to get the album artwork just in time. And we had to do it before it actually aired, because that was the kind of thing, you know, we wanted to kind of be ready, you know, so once it aired, you know, yeah, people could kind of connect the music.
Yeah. Yeah, we made sure it was all out in time, so that when and so that pushed me into a whole nother part of my job, which is obviously running my own label. I had to kind of like really quickly learn how to release music, because I'd never released music before and I didn't have a record deal still. I mean, I was signed as a writer to Sony ATV for publishing, which those guys have changed my life, and I'm still with them and I love them all. So many amazing people there. Hopefully I can get one of them to come and chat to us one day. I didn't have a record label, so normally you need a record label to put music out. But it was around that time in 2014, there were all these distribution companies popping up to allow people to be indie artists. And so I just jumped into that like full pelt and said, let's just release it. Let's just put it out there. Let's just start a profile on Instagram, a Facebook, a SoundCloud, a YouTube, and let's just put it out there and see what happens. And it was so overwhelming. I was not ready. I don't know if you were ready, because I think you might have been through this process before of like releasing a song, and it kind of like, I mean, before that I had nothing. I had no following. I had no fans. I had no access to anybody. I just had like my dreams. And then the song was on one episode of one TV show, which is obviously a cult following, and just my alerts on my phone and the SoundCloud and the YouTube just boom, like changed overnight.
Yeah, definitely. Like we, you know, cause we've had certain, you know, obviously experiences in our career where, you know, we've seen like big trajectories of like, we had a release and boom, things happen. And, you know, like, it's just so fast, but this was a little bit different, you know, as soon as it aired, it's almost like internet broke, like everywhere. Yeah. People are not only, you know, talking about the scene, but also talk about how good the song is, you know? And that was kind of cool to kind of see that simultaneous reaction. And, you know, yeah, and it just like, just took off after that. And it was like, man.
I know, and I wasn't expecting it. It was amazing.
So, yeah, we really wasn't expecting it, for sure, you know?
Yeah, and so after that, we got stuck into writing more stuff, and we finished the stuff we'd already started. And then the next thing that happened was knocking on Heaven's Door, but we'll talk about that another time. Yeah, so thank you, Pizzi, so much for joining us today, guys. That's pretty much the journey of Don't Let Me Go for the Vampire Diaries. Obviously, like, I know you guys, Vampire Diaries fans, X Factor fans. It's been on, where else was Don't Let Me Go used? It was on the SnowRunner game trailer. I don't know if there's any gamers out there, but it was on the game trailer for SnowRunner. And it's been used on some dance shows, like World of Dance, I think. But yeah, so I don't think the story of Don't Let Me Go is over yet. I think still stuff to come for that song. It's just been such a special song. So Pizzi, thank you so much for making that with me. And yeah, you guys are my favorite people. I love you so much. And we're working on some new stuff, aren't we? So
yes,
we're working on some new stuff. We're always working on new stuff. We never stop working on new stuff. But I'm really excited about what we're working on.
Yeah, new stuff.
Yeah.
Oh, great merch, by the way. So, you know, to kind of segue from, you know, her and her artwork, you know, because that's one of the things you always seen, like, you know, because, you know, you see people, you know,
oh, yeah, look, I'm wearing some
artwork,
now.
Different things, you know, but we always seen her kind of vision as, you know, something that you could hang up on a wall or, you know, something you'll see at the Louvre. You know, that's kind of when we was thinking art. Yeah, like at the
so
Louvre.
So ambitious.
You know,
I would
regal and, you know.
See, like, what would I do without you guys? You give me all the ambition.
Classic, very like classic look, you know. So I'm glad that, you know, the vision kind of still stuck and it just, you know, works so well, you know, with the music and everything. So
yeah, look, and here's the Don't Let Me Go t-shirt. It's actually called the Knocking on Heaven's Door t-shirt, this one. So this is the artwork that we made together, the four of us.
Oh wow.
Yeah. So it's got the
nice, yeah, and it's crazy, literally just in our boys' room, you know, just working on it for hours, and yeah, and it just came out.
I know, like, when you guys sent me back, because I remember sending you me with nothing, and then like a kind of rough sketch, and then you sent me this back. It was like I never could have even thought of this. Definitely set me off on, definitely set the bar for my artwork, and definitely set me off on a really interesting journey. But so this is So as Pizzi just mentioned, thank you. Oh, my dog's growling in his sleep. He's fast asleep growling. I have just opened the Rain Boutique, which is just a fancy name that I've given to my merch shop, because why not? And yeah, so there's so much stuff. I found a way of making and designing merchandise without it costing any money. So there's no inventory. So everything is made to order. So when you order a t-shirt, it gets made just for you. And so that gave me the flexibility to make everything with all my art, because I never could decide which artwork to put on something and whether to make a t-shirt or a hoodie or a sticker and that's it. No, I wanted to make everything. So I've had really good time in the pandemic. I wouldn't say I've had a good time in the pandemic. This pandemic's been awful for everybody, right? It's had some tough times. But I got myself through it by being creative with this art, because we weren't actually able to make music for a lot of the pandemic. We did it every now and then, but it was really tough for many reasons that you all have the same understanding of these reasons. I don't need to go into them. The world's opening up now, so let's focus on the positive. But I got really stuck into repurposing and reconfiguring the artwork to look right on different items. So I'm so excited. I love shopping. Shopping is like second favorite to music, so for me it's kind of just that's if nobody buys anything, because I'm just really nervous nobody's going to want anything, but I can just look at the shop and feel like I'm shopping, so it's cool. But anyway, so we've got this t-shirt, and then this is my artist pick. Can you see? So this, no, I can't figure this out. It's like back to front. So I love this hoodie, but I can't wear it out in public because it's got my own face on it. Can you still hear me? It's a bit weird wearing your own face on a top, but this is the Now I Can Fly hoodie. And there's a few more things too. But you guys can go and check it all out at the Rain Boutique and let me know what you think. And so anyway, once again, Pizzi.
Definitely send me that, the black one for sure.
Do you want a t-shirt or a hoodie?
I
or
see that design. Let me see it one more time.
You didn't see it?
Yeah. Yeah, that's fire. You gotta send me one.
I put the song titles around it to make it a bit more interesting. And then there's another version with the bigger version of the art, and the song titles are on the arm. But there's a hoodie, there's a vest top, there's a hat, there's pants, there's sneakers, high top canvas sneakers, there's posters, there's stickers, there's like anything you could think of with that art on. So you gotta go check that out. And yeah, so Pizzi, thank you so much. Can we please do this again? It was so fun. And these questions.
Yeah, it was super fun.
Let me see if there's any.
A live writing session next time.
Yeah, live. Oh my goodness. Would you guys like a live writing session? Let me see if there's any last few questions here. And also, that is actually such a beautiful story. I'm a gamer. Merch, please. You need that shirt. Well, you can find it at the Rain Boutique. So that's RAIGN Boutique. I always wear my jumper with my picture on it. I can't wear this out. I mean, I just wore it today because I really like it. And so why not? I'm just at home. But I could never walk around with my own face on my top. But yeah, I guess that is the story of Don't Let Me Go. So I'd love to spend more time with you all. We will definitely do this again. And we'll have Pizzi back again. And hopefully next time, Mysto as well, because he's the most amazing guy as well. I love him to bits. And watch this space. Make sure you're following me on Instagram, Facebook. Make sure you're following Mysto and Pizzi on those two. And also subscribe to the YouTube channel to make sure you get your alerts in case we do any more of these for when we do more. Yeah, all my links are in my Instagram, and we are working on new music, but it probably won't come out until sort of later in the year. Things take a minute, but we are working on more music. So thank you so much to all of you again for your support. And if there's any questions I haven't answered, you can DM me and I'll try and answer them, or I'll answer any overflow questions on my Instagram stories later today. Thank you so much, Pizzi. Thank you so, so much. See you.
Thank you. Thank you.
See you all later.
Take care, everyone.
Bye.
Later.